Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Okay, I think we can get started. So welcome to our morning session, which we're kicking off with a Posner lecture. And Posner lectures are named after Ed Posner, who is one of the founders of the NIPS conference. And by tradition, our Posner lectures go to invited speakers who have really been at the heart of the NIPS community. And I'm sure you will all agree that Daphne Koller is one of these people who's contributed tremendously to this community over many years. So Daphne has done an incredible range of work within machine learning and beyond, is well known for her work in computational biology, for her monumental textbook with Nir Friedman on probabilistic graphical models, and her work in Bayesian learning. But in the last few years, Daphne has dedicated herself to the online learning revolution. And it's fair to say that her work with her colleagues on Coursera has really transformed the educational landscape throughout the world. And so we're really delighted to have her here as one of our community, but to tell us about the transformative effect that Coursera has had and how perhaps we can help help this happen. Okay, thanks. So let's thank Daphne.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for being here. It feels weird to be at a NIPS and give a talk that has almost no machine learning content, as you will see. So for those of you who are expecting, you know, deep insights about probabilistic graphical models, you're in the wrong talk, and I apologize for that in advance. But I did put in some machine learning in bits and pieces to remind ourselves that I used to do that before I did this. But before I actually get into the topic of this talk, I would like to start with something that is not quite as happy as this talk. I would like to start this talk with a tribute to my PhD student, Ben Tasker. I know that Ben's death at a very young age of 36 was already mentioned at the opening remarks of this conference, but just a few words about Ben. So Ben's career actually was launched here at this conference when he, together with Carlos Gestrin, Carlos, are you here? Hi, Carlos. Won the Best Student Paper Award at NIPS 2003 for a paper entitled Maximum Margin Markov Networks, which is one of the handful of papers that really, I think, launched the area of discriminatively trained graphical models with all of the many applications that have since emerged in text, in natural language, in biology, in computer vision, and in many other areas. Ben was a remarkable individual because he was not only a tremendously gifted researcher, this paper was only one of many seminal contributions that he went on to make in not only in core machine learning, but in so many of the other areas from machine learning. He was also a really amazing human being. He was funny, he was kind, he was generous. He was just a pleasure to be with, and he had a genuine good nature that is not often found together with the kind of remarkable talent that he displayed as an academic and a researcher. And so I think his loss is a tremendous loss to our community and a particular loss to the many of us here in this room who have had the chance to be influenced by Ben, either directly, those of us who knew him, and also those of us who were influenced indirectly by the work that he did. Ben left behind him a wife and a two-year-old daughter who is severely disabled and needs round-the-clock care. So for any of you who are interested in helping them, there's a website that's listed at the top of this, and there is a place for you to try and make their life a little bit easier. So before I start, I'd just like maybe just a few seconds of silence in memory of Ben Taskar, and then I'll get into the talk. Okay, thank you for listening to that. So let me now talk about something that I hope is happier. I hope we'll be happier. So I'm going to tell you about work that really started just a little over 2 years ago in a grand experiment that we did at Stanford University in collaboration with my colleague and co-founder, Andrew Ng, another well-known NIPS insider, and together with two other colleagues, Sebastian Thron, another NIPS faithful, and Jennifer Whittem, our department chair in computer science, as well as a large number of other people. We took three courses in computer science and put them out in the wide world for anyone around the world to take for free. We were expecting, since these were pretty advanced courses, one of them is Andrew's machine learning class, and the other is Sebastian's artificial intelligence class, we were expecting an enrollment of a few thousand people, but within a matter of weeks, each of those courses had an enrollment of 100,000 students or more. Now, the number 100,000 is not one that we often hear in academic circles. And so to put that number in perspective, the largest of these classes as taught at Stanford is Andrew's machine learning class, has an enrollment of 400 students every time it's taught. So it's one of those large lecture classes that we all know and love to criticize, right? But in order for Andrew to teach that same size audience that he managed to reach in his online class by teaching a Stanford class, he would have to teach a Stanford class for 250 years. And by doing so, he would reach 250 generations of highly privileged Stanford students, as opposed to the students from every age group, every country, and every walk of life that were able to benefit from having access to this content. And so that really sort of established, I think, an opportunity that was impossible to pass up. How do you take the kind of content that had been available only to a privileged handful of people and make it available to anyone around the world at what is effectively a close to zero marginal cost per student? And so in order to execute on that opportunity, we decided in January of 2012 to spin this out of Stanford and work with not just Stanford courses, but courses from multiple top universities to offer an education to people everywhere. We launched in April 2012. We had four university partners, Stanford, Princeton, Penn, and Michigan, 37 courses, and 200,000 legacy students from the Stanford courses in the fall. Today, this is a relatively recent web shot, but it's impossible to keep updated. We have 107 university partners teaching 550-some courses to about 5.7 million students from every single country around the world. And by every single country, I mean including North Korea and Antarctica. I thought there were only penguins in Antarctica, but I was wrong. So let me talk a little bit about each of those numbers before we delve into the details. If you look at the top left, these are the US-based institutions that are working with us. I already mentioned the founding four, but you can recognize here the logos of many of the US finest academic institutions, both private and public, institutions like Columbia, Yale, Duke, Rice, Washington, Wisconsin, UC San Diego, and many, many others. But although we started out as a US-based effort, that is not where we ended up. It turned out that in recent months, we have actually become more non-US than US. We have more non-US institutions than US institutions. And our non-US institutions come from all from 20-some countries around the world. We have institutions from Europe, Asia, Latin America, Australia, Canada, and some of the world's finest institutions are there. And because of that breadth, we're now able to offer courses taught natively in nine different languages, in addition to the many English language courses that we have. The courses started out in computer science, and we have some amazing computer science courses, including some courses in machine learning and deep learning and all sorts of good stuff like that. But it didn't. That's not everything that's there. There's courses in philosophy, in astronomy, biology, business, medicine, philosophy, anything. I mean, pretty much anything that you want to study, there are courses in that discipline over there. The last thing I'm going to talk about is the students, because that's really the heart of this whole thing. And I can talk about students for hours, because every week we get dozens, sometimes hundreds of student testimonials via email and via the forums telling us about the transformative effect that access to a high quality education for free has had on their lives. But I'm just going to highlight a small number of examples to illustrate the importance of access for different kinds of people. This is Amanda, she's from Dominica. And she says, Coursera makes studying easier for me. I could sit at home and learn like I'm at school, no distractions. I could earn certificates without spending a dime to get to my local school. It helps me a lot since my mom is in the hospital, and financially, I cannot afford to attend school. This is Arti from India. Arti says, I was devastated as I had left my job and was finding out new directions in life. I wanted to go back to academics and could not find a way to do so. One of my friends recommended Coursera, and it was like a new life to me. I was thrilled to see so many courses and so many ways of learning. Thanks to Coursera, I got admission into one of the premier schools in my country, an IIT, as it happens, and I could continue my academics. So she's now an engineering student in an IIT. This is Jose from the Philippines, who says, I took the class on experimental genome science. The course was very, very challenging. I had to do some of the coursework during lunch at work. There's a different kind of commitment needed in taking online courses, a stronger sense of personal integrity required for it. I got an interview for a job I really desire, and I mentioned that I was taking the course, and now I have a new job evaluating genomic research proposals. Funny how that works. This one came in about a month ago and really brought tears to the eyes of many of us at the company. This one's anonymous. 2 years ago, I felt incredibly miserable. I'm coming from a traditional family, so I married young, and all my life I was either pregnant, breastfeeding, or both. I knew that I'm talented, but all I had in life was cleaning, feeding, working part-time. I wanted very much to study like my classmates, but it was very hard to find time. I started and left. I was deeply depressed, and there was a moment when I tried to kill myself. But we humans are very tenacious of life, and I survived. At that time, I found Coursera, my first course called The Game Theory, expelled the depression and desire to die once and forever. I feel happy and I enjoy my life and my family much more. In the last 2 years, I've taken about 40 courses. I'm addicted. Coursera breathes life into me. It gave me hope. I know that when my kids will grow up in 10 to 15 years, I will leave everything and go to Oxford. I dream about it. As Charles Dickens once said, suffering has been stronger than all other teaching. I've been bent and broken, but I hope into a better shape. And finally, this is the last one, is a very different one. This is Daniel. He's a 17-year-old boy who's severely autistic. He has a speaking vocabulary of about 150 words. He communicates by typing on an iPad designed by his father. And by doing so, he was the star student in the University of Pennsylvania Modern Contemporary American Poetry class, considered challenging even by University of Pennsylvania standards. Daniel says that not only is this the first meaningful educational experience that he's had after a life of special ed, that the rigor of this type of course also helps diminish the severity of his disease. We get a lot of emails from people who have the different kinds of either cognitive or physical or emotional disabilities. A lot of veterans, for example, with post-traumatic stress disorder, and for them this is the only way to have access to an educational experience. So with that, I'm now going to move into a little bit of more of a deep dive into what these courses look like on the inside. So we tried to make these courses not like, just open courseware that you go and you browse and you leave and that's it, but rather like a college course experience. That is, you come in and you feel like a college student. So the course begins on a given day. Every week there's material the students need to learn and homework they need to submit. And the homework is graded. And if they don't submit it, they don't pass the course. And you can see the impact of that very simple intervention in the usage graph that we see over here. X-axis is time, Y-axis is load on the site. And you see the heartbeat pattern? You know what that is? Every week, It's the day before the deadline. Every week. And I guess showing that procrastination really is a truly global phenomenon. And then at the end, if you actually did your homework and submitted it on time, there is a credential, which I'll talk about a little bit about what it is and what it means. So let's talk about the different aspects of the student interaction. First of all, there's the lectures themselves. And we try to make this feel like an on-campus lecture so that there is a real instructor teaching you, but at the same time, break away from the shackles of on-campus teaching in the sense that you have to teach in 15-minute blocks. So these are short, pointed videos of about 8 to 10 minutes each that make a very concrete point. And then within each of those, there's also interactivity. So I'll show that what that looks like. This is the University of Michigan model thinking class, I hope. It'll come up in a second. Usually does. Okay, it didn't. Right again. Okay. You can see this is Professor Scott Page teaching. He writes on the slides. The video hits the yellow notch over there and pauses, and the students get asked a question. The student gets to answer the question. They're told immediately if they're right or wrong, get a chance to try again. This is the kind of question that we as instructors might use to engage our students in an on-campus class. But when we do that, what typically happens, at least in my classes, is that 80% of the students, those that are not on Facebook at least, are still scribbling the last thing I said. And then there's the smarty pants in the front row, always the same guy, who answers the question before anyone else has even realized that a question had been asked. And then the class moves on. Here, every single student engages with the material, and so it gives a much more of engaging of a student experience. Now, you don't have to use this for just questions. So this is Professor Dan Ariely, a very famous professor from Duke University, who taught the irrational behavior class. And he uses these in-video quizzes, as we call them, as a way of surveying students about questions and that he's discussing. And once the students submit the survey answer, their answers are compared to that of the distribution of students in 50,000 or 100,000 people. Now, of course, these little baby questions inside the lecture is not where the meaningful learning happens. That has to happen in the weekly homeworks. So how do you grade the work of 100,000 students when your university refuses to fund 5,000 teaching assistants? Very stingy. So we've put in place two different mechanisms for doing this. One, each of them has its own benefits in addition to scalability. The first is computer-based grading, and computers are now capable of grading a pretty impressive array of work. You know, there's good old multiple choice, short answers like you saw in the video. Math expressions can be graded not on syntactic identity, but on semantic equivalence. And computer programs, computer models, and Excel spreadsheets, anything that has a structured output as can be graded by a computer as well. So here are some examples of places where people have used this very creatively. This is one of our instructors from Georgia Tech who taught a class called Introductory Physics 1 with Laboratory. Now, you're probably scratching your head saying, how do you do a lab class when your students are all the way from Ghana to Bangladesh and don't have access to a lab? So what Mike did is he had them do the experiments with objects that are in their own environment, like balls and tables and things. So here, for example, is the, you know, a girl throwing a ball. And he had them record the experiment with their cell phone. Now, and submit, but the question is, of course, then how do you know what the ground truth is when you don't know the mass of the ball or the friction coefficient of the table or anything else? So what he did is he developed image processing software. I don't know how many of you can see the red dots on that diagram that track the ball and compute the accelerations and velocities and so on and so forth, giving him a ground truth that he can use for grading the student's work. So you could do some pretty cool stuff if you want to be creative on how you exploit the technology. Here's another cool example. This is the intro to Python class from Rice University. And they actually had students, they wrote a simulator for Python in the browser using JavaScript so that the students could actually get immediate, they could program in the browser instead of on the server on the client and get immediate feedback on whether they're right or wrong. Okay. Now the one interesting, important aspect of this auto-grading technology is that it's not just a scalability mechanism, it also has important advantages, and specifically the immediacy of the feedback that it provides to students. So instead of giving the students the feedback 3 to 4 weeks after the material was taught, as is typical in a campus class by the time the work is graded, by which point it's really too late for them to realize, well, you know, I didn't get it, I should go back and relearn. Here the feedback is immediate, and so they're incentivized to basically treat this like a computer game and try again. And I'll show results in a little bit that indicate the relevance of that from a pedagogical perspective. That's the machine learning part of the talk. So the other mechanism that we've put in place for scale at scale grading is peer grading. This is intended to deal with the kind of work that computers at least currently cannot grade. Open-ended essays, design projects, course designs, if you're a teacher learning how to be a teacher and things like that. So here, for example, is indeed a course from the teacher professional development category that we have on, and the assignment is to construct a lesson plan. So in order to do that grading, what we have is we use a mechanism called peer grading, where students are, once they submit their own work, are given a grading rubric designed by the instructor that allows them to grade the work of their peers. And the rubric tells them exactly what to look for, how many points to ascribe to each thing, and each piece of work is graded by 5 students, which are then aggregated using a mechanism that actually uses machine learning on the inside to gauge quality of the reviewer, and the result is presented to the student as their score together with the qualitative feedback. So here's what one of these grading rubrics might look like. Now you might ask whether this type of grading is going to give accurate results. Are students who are not experts in the discipline capable of doing this kind of grading? And the answer is it depends on the grading rubric. So here is an example from an Intro to Sociology class at Princeton University. This is the final exam, 3 essay questions, pretty hard essay questions. And what you see here is a comparison between the x-axis, which are the scores assigned to these final exams, about 1,200 of them, by the 2 TAs in the course. This was done, generally TAs don't grade these assignments, but in this case it was done as a comparison point. And the y-axis is the scores assigned by peer grading, and you can see there is a very strong correlation between those two scores, demonstrating that if the rubric is well designed, you can really get very reproducible results from this kind of mechanism. Now, the other aspect of peer grading is that it also conveys interesting pedagogical benefits, because students consistently tell us that they learn as much or more from grading the work of their peers as they do from doing the work themselves, because it teaches them how to critically assess whether a piece of work is good or bad. And in many cases, the instructor asks them to then go back and use the same rubric on their own work once they're done. And so they can really then introspect on whether they did a good job and where they might have done better. And so again, this gives rise to a much deeper learning experience than simply getting a 73 back on your paper. And now we have a lot of instructors that are using this technology in their on-campus courses, not because of the scalability benefits, but simply because of the pedagogical advantages that it confers to students. And then finally, peer grading allows us to do at-scale grading for courses that you wouldn't think could ever be done as a massive open online course. Here, for example, is the Wharton Business School design class. And this is an 8-week project class, where in each week the students submit a progressively more and more advanced design for a project. And each week they get feedback from 5 of their peers, so that by the end of the course, they've gotten 40 pieces of feedback and have produced some pretty remarkable designs. And we have students who've gone on to create companies based on the designs that they generated in this course. Like there's a company that is based on an ice cream scoop that was designed. So. Now, peer grading leads naturally to the last piece of the student experience in these courses, which is that of community. And it is that that in many ways distinguishes these courses from many of the other previous versions of online education. Community is an intrinsic part of these courses because of their scale. First, because when you have 100,000 students, it's not possible for an instructor to engage in meaningful ways with many of the individual students. But at the same time, you also have the opposite side of the coin, that when the community is that large and that rich, there's going to be, for any question that you ask, an expert somewhere in that cohort who's not only knowing the answer, but interested in helping you figure it out. And so people get answers to their questions, often in a matter of minutes, and in many cases, very detailed and thoughtful answers, much more than an instructor would have the time to produce for these questions. Now, the other aspect of this is that this is not only a large community, it's also a very heterogeneous one. The students come from every single country in the world in many cases, or dozens of different countries, and especially for courses that have a contextualization, courses in sociology, in medicine, in business, in sustainability, where the local context really changes people's perspectives. You get a tremendous wealth of perspectives from the dialogue that you have with other students in the class, and you really learn to see how somebody in China thinks about environment and sustainability very differently from somebody in Nigeria, for example. And as a consequence, many of the instructors that have taught these MOOCs are now asking their on-campus students to participate in the MOOC, even if the lecture materials are still taught in class, just so that they can benefit from the richness of the interaction. Now, virtual interaction is all well and good, but we have found that people, at least many people, naturally gravitate to have some face-to-face interaction. So organically, people have created study groups in different cities around the world. And these study groups meet in people's homes or workplaces or in coffee shops, and they talk about the course that they're all taking together and help each other over the hard bits. And there's now thousands of these communities around the world that combine face-to-face discussion with the online content. I'd like to talk about one of these communities that really inspired an effort that we're currently undertaking. This is a group of people who are not among life's most fortunate. It's a group of middle-aged minority women in a very poor part of Ohio. Only one of them has a college education. All of them are either unemployed or working in low-paying jobs. They were brought together by a woman called Sharon Watkins. She's standing there on the top left. And they together picked a class to take. It happened to be an entrepreneurship class from the Darden Business School, a top-ranked business school in the United States. And they took it together. And the interesting statistics on this is that 10 of them started the course, 9 of them stuck it through the end, and 6 of them passed an MBA-level final exam. Which I think for this, given where they were starting from, this is an amazing achievement. So this really inspired us to value the combination of face-to-face teaching or face-to-face discussion when combined with online content. And so to leverage on that, a couple of months ago, we announced a project called Learning Hubs, which is a collaboration with a number of organizations, including the US State Department. And the US State Department specifically is now using spaces in embassies and embassy employees to create these study groups and facilitate these study groups for people who normally would not have internet access or the ability to have a quiet place to study with other people. So this is the current map of the learning hubs that we have around the world. There's 30 of them. But since we launched this project a couple of months ago, we've had over 50 organizations reach out to us, some with as many as thousands of spaces in a given country that want to basically make these spaces available to people in the context of these learning hubs. And let me emphasize that this is all on a volunteer basis. That is, neither the spaces nor the facilitators are getting any payment for this, and certainly the students aren't paying. Which brings us, I guess, to the question of revenue and where that comes from. How do you provide a free education to people while making this sustainable? And so one mechanism that we've put in place so far, and there's others that we're thinking about, is what we call the signature track or the verified certificate. So many of these students are here just because they want to learn. But some of them are interested in taking that learning and proving to others that they've mastered the material and using that to get, for example, a better job. And for those students who get a tangible benefit from this, there is an opportunity to opt in entirely optionally and pay for participation in an identity-verified track, which we call the signature track. Now, how does this work? When a student signs up for this, if they choose to do so, remember, access to the content is still free, they submit a government-issued picture ID, which is compared by a human to their webcam photo. And at the same time, they create a biometric profile, which uses keystroke verification. That is, it turns out that if Zubin and I type the same phrase, the rhythm's going to be very different. And no matter how hard I try, I can't really explain to Zubin how to type like me. And so it turns out to be a pretty cheap and readily available biometrics that one can use to identify people every time they log onto the platform and confirm that they are participating in their own learning, which means that if they then pass the course, we can give them a more meaningful credential that has this that has the university logo on it, among other things, even though it's not credit bearing. Now, this is not an expensive thing. We're currently charging about $50 for this, so it's not expensive. But because of the scales involved, we were able, even though it was a very slow ramp up, in the first 8 months of the program to make $1 million from this. So $1 million is not a huge amount of money, but it suggests that there is a sustainability model behind this. So the part that you've all been waiting for, data and learning, and this is both machine learning and human learning, but mostly human learning. So I mentioned earlier this notion of the immediacy of the feedback and the opportunity to resubmit as being an important component of the learning experience. And what it does is it induces what we call self-induced mastery learning, that is, students are motivated to try and try again. And you can see that in the graph on the right-hand side of this image, where the x-axis is how far away a student is from the optimal score, and the y-axis is the probability of resubmission. And what you see is that the students who need the help the most are most likely to resubmit, which is great. And what you can see on the left-hand graph is that indeed the final submission scores, which is the green graph, are considerably higher than the initial submission scores, which is the blue graph, so that the students actually do get better scores by being given the opportunity to resubmit. Now, of course, that begs the question of, well, does that actually help them learn, though, or is it just that they're allowed to try again? And so to do that, we did some pretty interesting analytics, pretty interesting in our standards, and tried to see the correlation between what we call the formative score improvements, so the improvements in these exercises where you're allowed to resubmit, and the final exam performance. Now, if you look at the trend line, which is the black line, you can see that the correlation is actually negative, right? Students who have more improvement on their formative scores actually perform worse on the final exam. So of course you sit there and scratch your head a little bit and you realize that if you want to analyze these data properly, you have to account for the fact that students who are doing really well to begin with just don't have a lot of room to improve. And so it's the students who are doing worse that have a lot of room for improvement, and so more room for improvement correlates with doing better on the final exam. And so in order to capture that, we actually stratified the students, you can see here, into different colored dots depending on their initial performance on a submission. And you can see that for every cohort, when you look at students that had equivalent initial baseline performance, the correlation becomes positive. And you can see that in this graph over here, where the unadjusted correlation coefficient across the 28 classes that we did this in is negative, but once you adjust it for these initial conditions, the correlation coefficient becomes positive. And so you have to analyze these data with care. And so the bottom line is, once you do the analysis properly, then you see that for students whose baseline performance is similar, this mastery-based score improvements does correlate with final exam performance. Okay, the other place where we've used data, and this is really a slide that I'm only showing here, I've never shown this slide in any other talk that I've given, is a slide about retention. People often say that these courses are not very good because only 5% of the people who enroll in the class actually complete the class, which is true. What people don't realize or choose not to think about is that most of the people who enroll in these classes, in which you can enroll for free, never have any intent to take the class for real. They're browsing. Or maybe they want to watch videos, but they don't ever want to do homework. And so if you want to analyze these data carefully and understand the concept of retention, you have to think about this in a much finer grained way. And so what we did here is we actually looked at the retention in terms of number of lecture hours watched. And you can see that is the red line. That's actually in my probabilistic graphical models class. And you can see the blue line is an attempt to fit this via an exponential distribution, which corresponds to natural attrition. And you can see it's a very bad fit. But the green line is fitting it with a two-component mixture distribution of exponentials that corresponds to basically a high retention and a low retention population. The ones that really wanted to take the class and the ones that are just browsing. And you can see that when you, this by the way is an excellent fit for the video watching behavior of almost all of our classes, and what you can see here is that you really see the retention rates, which is the parameter of the exponential distribution, being much, much lower in the low retention group and very high and consistently high in the high retention group across all classes. And along these lines, to further study this, we actually tried to get data that allowed us to stratify the population more actively into high retention and low retention as opposed to just computationally. So in a paper led by Andrew Moss, who's sitting here in the audience and talking about some of this. Andrew, are you here? Somewhere? Andrew's talking about it at the workshops later on this conference. We actually tried to figure out the effect of intent on student retention. And so we did this in two different ways. First, by looking at signature track as a signal of intent. And you would expect that somebody who signs up for signature track and pays $50 has at least some intention of completing the class. And so you can see that, again, whereas the overall retention rate is about 5%, the retention rate for signature track is 63%, which is much higher. And if you also ask students as they come in if they're really highly committed to completing the course, among the ones that answer yes, 64% of them complete the class. And if they put just a little bit of skin in the game, we go up to 88%. Now, 88% is actually really high for any online activity, including social games, far less something that requires 5 to 7 hours of challenging homework every week. Okay, so the final piece that I'd like to talk about is how this gives us a new window into human learning. And here is yet another place where big data can really come to help. So this is a graph of answers from Andrew's machine learning class. The answers happen to be pairs of numbers, coefficients in a regression. So each of these dots is a one-off wrong answer. The big dots, for example, the big cross at the top left, is where 2,000 students made the exact same mistake and ended up at the exact same answer in this infinite space. Now, when two students in a class of 100 make the same mistake, you'd never notice, but when it's a few thousand, that kind of jumps out at you. And so Andrew and his TAs went in, understood the basis for the misconception, and then instrumented the feedback mechanism so that every time a student's answer falls into that bucket, they don't just get a sorry you're wrong, they also get a, and you might want to think about it this way, personalizing the feedback to their own learning. Which brings us to one of, I think, what is potentially the biggest opportunities for all of us, and especially for you in the machine learning community who might be interested in this. So 30 years ago, a renowned education researcher, Benjamin Bloom, wrote a paper called The Two Sigma Problem, where he studied the achievement distribution in three populations: lecture-based in a mastery learning format, where students weren't allowed to move on to the second topic before demonstrating competency in the first, and students who had an individual human tutor. And Bloom points out that each of these interventions gives rise to a full standard deviation, or sigma, improvement in performance. In order to quantify what a two sigma improvement means, Bloom said, let's pick the median of the lecture-based population as a threshold. So by definition, in the lecture-based population, half are going to be above and half are going to be below. If you use that same threshold for the green population, 98% of students are going to be above that threshold. So here we have a lake woebegone in real life. 98% of the students are above average. Which would be a really cool thing to achieve, except that, as Bloom points out, and hence the title, The Two Sigma Problem, as a society, we cannot afford a human tutor for every student. So what do we do? Well, maybe we can afford a computer for every student. And if we can afford a computer for every student, the question then is, can we use, say, machine learning to move us from the blue curve to the red curve and ultimately to the green curve? Now, the red curve is actually well within reach. Computers are really good at mastery. They genuinely don't mind showing you the same video 5 times. It's okay. The green curve is going to require the intervention of people like you. Okay, the last piece of it is how we can use this to improve the quality of instruction for our own on-campus students, those that are privileged enough to attend an academic institution. So this is one of my favorite quotes by Edwin Slosson, who says, the college is a place where professors' lecture notes go straight to the students' lecture notes without passing through the brains of either. Not perhaps the most flattering view of a college education, but one that maybe is not unwarranted when you look at this. So what should we do instead? What we can do instead is the best of both worlds: high-quality online content, which can be either produced locally or adopted from a master lecturer at a peer institution. And then in class, you come and do what's called flipped classroom: active learning, problem solving, personalized attention to students using analytics that show you which are the students that are struggling, and so on, giving rise to much better learning outcomes. And this turns out to be more fun for both students and instructors. So here are some testimonials from instructors that have done this. I'm not going to read all of them, but for the one at the top is one of my favorites. It's from the two Rice instructors who taught the Python class. And they say, I will never, ever, ever teach a class any other way as far as I can tell. This is so much better. I had so much more fun teaching, and the students learned so much more. I will never get up here and lecture. I just don't see the point anymore. And the students learn better. These are results from the University of Wisconsin at Madison, actually done over the last decade, long before MOOCs came onto the scene. And you can see the left-hand side is a traditionally taught class. The right-hand side is one that's taught in this flipped classroom model. And the biggest effect is that the students who are failing are moved over into the passing grade. So where next? OK, perfect. The first observation about where next is an observation that's not due to me. It's one of our instructors, Christian Terwish, who taught the operations management class on Coursera, and whose last lecture, which is available on YouTube, is a case study of MOOCs from an operations management perspective. Christian argues that education by force is a trade-off along a Pareto optimal curve between faculty productivity, the number of students that an instructor can teach, say, per hour, versus student learning outcomes. And you can see, for example, that a large lecture hall, that's pretty productive. You can cover 300 people all at once, but the learning outcomes may be so-so. Individualized instruction, like office hours, great learning outcomes, very unproductive. Christian argues that MOOCs give us a new Pareto optimal frontier, and that you can use this in different ways depending on what your goals are. You can take the same quality of instruction as a large lecture hall and offer it not to hundreds, but to hundreds of thousands of students. So you're effectively increasing productivity. Or you can take the same amount of effort that an instructor currently puts into creating content, delivering content, and grading homework, and instead use that to do the kind of personalized and active learning instruction that we talked about. And so you don't improve costs, but you increase learning outcomes. And depending on what you want to do, there's different points along the spectrum that you can aim for. I'm going to skip past this and just go to the end, I think. So what implications does this have? And for that, I'm going to go back all the way to the beginning of this effort, which is right after we launched in April 2012. Thomas Friedman wrote up this effort in the New York Times. And Tom has quite a way with words, so I'm just going to adopt his. And he said that big breakthroughs are what happen when what is suddenly possible meets what is desperately necessary. So let me talk about desperately necessary for a moment. India wants to increase its post-secondary completion rate from 13 to 30%. 30% is low for OECDs, but it's within the spectrum of OECD countries. You cannot run a 21st century economy on 13%. In order for India to achieve this using traditional techniques, they would have to build 1,500 academic institutions. Now, even if you ignore the somewhat daunting logistics of building 1,500 campuses in India, the current situation is that even the current institutions and even the highest ranked ones just don't have enough qualified instructors to teach the students that they have. So within this generation, there's no ability to choose, solve this problem and offer education to everyone who wants it in these countries. And this is India, where the educational system is relatively well developed. Think about countries like Nigeria or Ghana, where there is virtually no qualified instructors. And you can see the magnitude of the problem and why we need to basically leapfrog brick and mortar and come up with another solution. And so that brings us to the what is suddenly possible. Only 30% of our students are in the United States, and this fraction has been constantly decreasing over time. 40% of the students are in what the US State Department defines as the developing world. And it's not just the BRIC countries. It's every country around the world, including some of the poorest countries. Somebody just came back from Myanmar, and they told me that they were talking to a group of people, and they were telling them, oh, you should try out this new online platform. It turns out that everyone was already on it in that audience. And so I think there is a tremendous opportunity for us to really take an educational experience that had been available only to a very small handful of privileged people and to make it a basic human right. And so I'm going to end this talk with one anecdote. Almost a year ago, I attended the launch of the Education First Initiative at the United Nations in New York. And they were talking about how one can aim to achieve the Millennium Development Goals of bringing education to, in this case, all of the school children around the world who are not currently in school. And they were talking about how you can travel to remote areas like refugee camps in the Congo, where people are living in grass huts on a cup of food a day. And you ask them what they most want. And they don't say more food, and they don't say better shelter. They say a better education for my children, because they know that that is really the only way for their children to break out of the cycle of poverty and have a chance at a better life. Thank you.
So we have some time for some questions.
So could you say something about China?
Yes.
How are the MOOCs doing there?
Well, I'm glad you asked that, because for a while they were actually doing pretty badly, and that's primarily because of the firewall, and not because the firewall was blocking us, but simply because passing video through the firewall was exceptionally painful. And so about a month ago, we did a China launch with a Chinese partner called NetEase that runs the fifth largest website in China. And they're doing two things for us. They're, first of all, mirroring the videos within China behind the firewall, so that now access to the videos is very fast. All of the student data is still stored on US servers because we didn't want to risk privacy issues, but the videos are stored in China. And then they also are providing a site, basically a portal into the Coursera content from their site, which is, as I said, the fifth largest in China. And since then, enrollments in China have spiked and have actually surpassed enrollments in India, which is kind of on a daily basis, not a cumulative. And that's really amazing, because India has always been our second largest country after the United States. And so I think there is a great hunger for this kind of content in China once you overcome the technological barriers and the language barriers. So we're also translating the content into Chinese, the subtitles, and that also has had a huge effect. We also have, I think at this point, 5 or 6 Chinese-speaking universities that are teaching content in Chinese, including the, you know, some of the bigger ones like Peking University and Fudan and Shanghai Jiao Tong and National Taiwan University and so on.
It's still a bit sad, maybe, that only the people who can afford to buy a certificate can get the certificate and create opportunities for them. So is there maybe a way that you can sort of own, so everybody gets a certificate, but only the people who can sort of afford it actually pay for it?
Okay, so I'm glad you asked that question. I skipped over this slide for lack of time. First of all, everyone gets what we call a statement of accomplishment that doesn't have the identity verification, but that's not the interesting part. The interesting part is that we put in place a financial aid program, which is called which is really a fee waiver program. So if you want the certificate and you can't afford it and you really need it, you fill out basically a couple paragraphs on why you need it, a couple paragraphs on why you can't afford it, a couple paragraphs on how you intend to comply with the honor code, and you get the certificate for free. And about 20-ish percent of our certificates are actually financial aid. And we were insistent with our engineers, they hated us that week. We said, this is not launching. Signature track is not launching until the financial aid pages are in place as well.
So just with Mark's question, why don't you do the opposite? Give everybody a certificate and have the people who want to verify them pay.
That's effectively what we're doing. So the certificate, the statement of accomplishment is an unverified certificate.
Yes, but it cannot be verified later on.
No, you have to opt in at the very beginning of the course, because we do the identity verification every week, because otherwise, at the end of the course, you say, yeah, I took the course, and we don't know if it was you or your brother who took it.
Yes, but the certificate is to be used by people who want to verify that this person has taken the course.
Oh, that actually I think is not a good idea, because it puts all the friction on the employer side, and employers are just not going to want to mess with it, and I think it's actually going to be worse for the students. This is $50 we're talking about. It's less than the price of a meal for a lot of students. And for the ones who can't afford it, like I said, we have the financial aid program, so.
So, it seems like one of the logistical difficulties would be...
Sorry, where are you?
Over here.
Oh, thank you.
So it seems like one of the logistical difficulties is access to computers and internet.
Yeah.
And so do you keep tabs on how programs for distributing access to these things are going? And
yeah. So I think this is a multifaceted answer. So first of all, we know that in many countries, people have been adopting all sorts of interesting ways of getting access. So for example, in Iran, we know that there was a kid who was basically burning DVDs and distributing them to various places in the country. We put in place the Learning Hubs program as a way of giving people access to the internet when they might not normally have it. But I think ultimately the digital divide is a much larger problem than we can solve on our own, and it's something that society is going to have to deal with, and fortunately that's starting to happen. So India, to come back to that example, has just finished laying a broadband network to 250,000 Indian villages. This is not every village, but every village is now within driving distance of one that has high-speed broadband, and so you can drive there, basically download the stuff that you need, and then go home, work for a week, and come back the following week. And on the other side of this, the Indian government is subsidizing the development and distribution of the Akash tablet, which is not as cool as the iPad, but it's fully functional and costs $40 to produce and $20 once the Indian government subsidizes it. And so that solves the device problem for a lot of people in India. And so between those two interventions together, combined with the fact that we're hard at work on a mobile app that will allow you to do offline work, that will help address the problem gradually as other countries begin to adopt solutions that are similar to India's.
Thank you. Maybe on that side. There's a question there.
Opportunities for donations.
You were working on that. We haven't, but you can buy a lot of signature track certificates. You just go on the site and we need to do that. Well, actually what we're putting in place is not so much a donation, but a way to donate to people so that they can get the signature track certificate, sort of a way to donate to the financial aid program. We just haven't had time to put that into place. So in the meantime, you can just buy it for your children, your nieces, your students in your class, and we will be very grateful.
Don't you already need a pretty good basic education to take these university-level courses?
Yeah, so the target audience for a lot of these is high school and above, although some of the entry-level courses like pre-algebra and pre-calculus, and the physics one that I showed really are aimed at equally good for a high school population. So I agree that in many parts of the world, the problem with education begins a lot earlier than college. It begins in primary and secondary education. We don't think that what we have is the right user experience to teach a 7-year-old how to read. And so in order to help address that problem, what we put in place, and I briefly alluded to, is a teacher professional development program. There is a teacher shortage of 2 million teachers in the developing world if you're going to meet the Millennium Development Goals of getting every child in school by 2015. There's no way to train 2 million teachers within that time frame using traditional techniques. And so we put in place this teacher professional development opportunity so that we can help create more teachers and better teachers. And hopefully that's going to put a dent in that problem.
We'll take two more questions. I think we have one there.
Hi. I've read reports that some students in this country would prefer to get a certificate from, let's say, a Stanford than a local community college. And some local community colleges and lower tier universities aren't able to respond to this new trend. So what advice would you give them?
I think that we are coming into a world where content and high quality content is about to become a commodity. And that every academic institution, not just community colleges, even the Stanfords and Princetons of the world, are going to have to think about what is the value proposition that they give to students beyond just the content. And I think the value proposition exists. It certainly exists, at a place like Stanford and such, that the ability to interact with leading scholars of the day is a clear value proposition. But at community colleges, I think the value proposition is equally clear. Many of these students coming into community colleges are there because they were not able to acquire in high school the study skills that they need to succeed. And what they have in the community college is a bunch of really passionate, dedicated teachers who can help them acquire those skills and actually get to the point where they can do college-level work at a 4-year institution. And so I think that that is the value proposition that community colleges offer and they need to leverage as they reach out to students. And I think the same applies to any institution of higher education. If the only thing that your institution does in its classroom experience is offer an experience that is equivalent to what students can get online in a MOOC, you better rethink if that's if you should be in this business, I think.
So I have, the question I have, it's interesting that you have these two tiers of awarding kinds of certificates. Mm. Are you planning to go up further and give something more akin to degrees that university can stand behind? Because you could imagine people coming in person to take maybe a test or two, a sample of tests to verify.
I think there isn't a lot. I mean, we're not planning to become a degree-granting institution ourselves. We're not accredited. We have. I mean, we're a platform. We're a technology company. We're not an education company. If there were going to be credentialing done, it would have to be done by our university partners. Currently, there is a growing comfort with these unofficial credentials that are mostly aimed not as a substitute for degrees, but rather mostly at a continuing education population. The vast majority of the people who seek these credentials are people who already have college degrees and are using it to bolster their marketability in the job market, for example. And they're comfortable with that. Not many of them are currently comfortable with providing credit for these courses, but this is a landscape that's shifting so quickly that I wouldn't be surprised to see that happening in a matter of, I would say, a year or two at the most, given how fast things are moving.
Thanks. Okay, I know the audience is bursting with more questions, and that's just an indication of how inspiring Daphne's talk has been. So let's thank Daphne again. Okay, our next talk is going to be presented by Robert Lindsay, and this is on optimizing instructional policies, joint work with Michael Moser, William Huggins, and Harold Peschler.
Thanks. I knew Daphne would be a hard act to follow, so when I began preparing this talk, I had to choose a theme for my slides that would be as cool as Daphne's. So I chose this one. My advisor thought this one was cool. Now, choosing a slide theme may not have much impact on how well you learn and remember my presentation, but educators face more substantive decisions about how to teach, that is, what instructional policy to employ. For example, an instructor has to choose what material to cover, in what order to cover it, and at what pace. Let me illustrate with a simple example. So before coming to this conference, you might have wanted to make flashcards to learn the names of faces you're likely to meet. So given a fixed amount of time to run through these flashcards, you'd have to decide how to study. For example, is it better to study each face once for 2 seconds per face? Or in that same amount of time, is it better to study each face twice for 1 second per face? We could conduct an experiment with the audience and have half the room study using the first method and the other half using the second method. And then we could test everyone's memory afterward and determine which method produces a statistically reliable advantage. A problem with this approach is that there's a continuum of training policies, and what we really want to do is identify the optimal policy. A way to find the best policy is to learn this implicit population performance, the blue line, which maps any training policy to a population-wide average performance. We then can treat the search for the best training policy as a function optimization problem. We've taken a Bayesian active learning approach to the function optimization. Suppose we've already collected data from individuals at various points in the policy space. Each one of these black dots represents the outcome from testing a single person. These data points are very noisy because testing any one because any one test of any one individual doesn't well represent the population statistics. But we can use the noisy data to do function approximation. In particular, we use Gaussian process regression. Gives an estimate of the mean of the performance function, shown here as the dashed line, and a representation of the uncertainty about that mean, which I'm showing here through the CDF. Given the Gaussian process posterior, we can use an active selection strategy to choose a new policy to evaluate via a human experiment. We used an upper confidence bound heuristic. This uses the cumulative distribution function to select the policy which has the most mass above a certain performance level. It's meant to balance exploration and exploitation. In this case, the selected policy is indicated by the vertical pink line. We then test a new participant trained under this policy and iterate the procedure. For our domain, a draw from a Gaussian process prior represents the latent population-wide effectiveness of training policies. We indirectly measure the effectiveness by testing individuals through a multiple choice exam. To link the effectiveness to the observed exam scores, we use a chance-corrected beta binomial observation model. This generative model first maps the policy's population-wide effectiveness through a logistic function to get a mean population accuracy. It then draws an individual's accuracy through a beta distribution, which is then adjusted for chance guessing. And finally, a binomial draw determines the individual's exam score. Because of this non-Gaussian observation model, we needed to perform approximate inference, which we did through elliptical slice sampling. In the first of two experiments we ran on Amazon Mechanical Turk, participants were trained to do a task very similar to the flashcard example. Instead of learning to associate faces with names, they had to learn to associate faces with the names of the person's favorite sports team, either Jets or Sharks. They had 30 seconds to learn to make this face sports team association, and during training, each face was shown for D milliseconds. Immediately following training, participants underwent a two alternative forced choice test in which they had to select each person's team. Participants repeated this training and testing cycle for a total of 8 times, each time they saw a different set of faces. We're interested in discovering the presentation duration that produces the strongest memory. On one extreme, we can present each face for 250 milliseconds at a time. Because the total training time is constant, this means that each face gets presented 20 times. On the other extreme, we could present each face for 5,000 milliseconds at a time. This means that each face gets presented only once in the entire training period. There are advantages to either extreme. A short duration is desirable because having many presentations is good, and a long duration is desirable because having more time to process each face is good. And the question is, where between these trade-offs the optimum is. We used our active learning scheme and Gaussian process regression model to explore this policy space. The horizontal axis of this graph shows the presentation duration in milliseconds on a log scale, and the vertical axis shows the percent correct during testing. As before, each circle represents a single participant trained under policy and then given an exam. We began by running one participant, estimating the model, querying our active selection heuristic to choose a new policy, running the next participant under that policy, and then iterating. In total, we tested 100 participants in the policy space, and we considered only values of the presentation duration that lead to an integer number of trials. The optimum, according to this search process, is approximately 1150 milliseconds. To contrast our method with the traditional experimental paradigm in psychology, we tested the same total number of participants in 5 hand-selected training policies, and so there were 20 participants per policy. These policies correspond to presenting each face exactly 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 times during training. The results from traditional experiments are very noisy, but they're consistent with our model predictions. Because our model is taking into account the noise in the data and obtaining a smooth estimate, and because we collected observations across the whole space, we get a clearer picture of the entire policy space and a more meaningful estimate of where the optimum lies, despite our having run the same number of subjects. The optimum we discovered may not seem surprising in retrospect, but we informally polled our psychologist colleagues before revealing the results and got a wide range of predictions. So I'm going to turn now to a second experiment, which has a more nuanced policy space. In this experiment, participants are told that Martians have come to Earth and are teaching them the Martian word glopnor. Now, not knowing our language, the Martians can only communicate this word through positive and negative examples of glopnor. During a training phase, participants go through a series of trials, and on each trial, a participant sees an object and is asked whether or not the object is glopnor. They make a response and then receive feedback. In this case, they're told that grapes are glopnor. On each following trial, another object is presented to be classified, and the previous object and its correct classification are shown in the top right as a reminder. Participants continue through this training process for a total of 25 trials, and if anyone can guess what glopnor is from these few examples, I'm very surprised. This concept learning task is difficult because the presented objects differ along so many dimensions, any one of which could be relevant for the learning task. So, unbeknown to the participants, the word glopnor meant graspability, or the ease of picking up and manipulating the object with one hand. The images we presented during training were normed by asking a large group of people to rate each object on a 1-5 scale, indicating how graspable it is. We drew the category boundary at the midpoint of this scale. if you don't know what the concept is, examples further away from the boundary might be easier to learn from because they exaggerate the critical dimension. In fact, psychologists for many years have explored the benefits of a manipulation in which you begin training people with examples far from the boundary and move toward the boundary. This is known as fading among psychologists and as curriculum learning among machine learning researchers. One way to visualize fading is through a graph like this, where the horizontal axis shows the training trial number, and the vertical axis shows the exemplar's distance to the category boundary. A common fading strategy is this purple trajectory, which transitions from far to near the boundary. This is in contrast to strategies which always present examples near the boundary or always present examples far from the boundary. We can frame these alternatives as being part of a larger continuum of policies, where each policy in this continuous space specifies a particular fading strategy. That's illustrated here by these many new lines. This continuous range of fading strategies forms the first dimension of our policy space for this experiment. Psychologists have also considered blocking as an interesting manipulation. This refers to the sequence of positive or negative examples of the concept being taught. A block strategy has many repetitions of the category from one trial to the next. This is in contrast to an interleave strategy, which has the category alternating from one trial to the next. Of course, the extent to which we employ a blocked or interleave strategy can change over time. We can specify this change through a repetition probability, which determines how likely each trial's exemplar is to be drawn from the same category as the previous trials. Some theoreticians believe that it's good to have repetitions early in training and alternations late, as shown by this green arrow. We might also consider the opposite strategy of having many alternations early and in training and many repetitions late. And we can consider any number of policies in between these extremes where the midpoint is just the random selection of categories. This continuous range of time-dependent blocking strategies forms the second dimension of our policy space. In this experiment, we also ran on Mechanical Turk. Participants were trained using objects selected according to their assigned instructional policy. Then in a testing phase, there were 24 randomly ordered trials in which participants made responses without feedback. In the testing phase, exemplars spanned the full range of the rating scale and were chosen independently from the instructional policy. This graph shows the end result of our active search in this 2D policy space after we tested about 200 participants. As before, each dot represents a policy at which one or more participants were trained. The size of each dot reflects the number of participants trained at that point in the space. The black and white shading of the graph represents the model's prediction of the mean recall accuracy on the exam, which again the model estimates by using this smattering of noisy single participant evaluations. Since the exam we used to evaluate participants had only two choices, Sklopner or not, chance performance is at 50% accuracy. The optimal policy according to the search method is shown here by the star. It corresponds to a partial fading strategy which begins with objects far from the category boundary and shifts to objects somewhat near the category boundary. And the optimum corresponds to a blocking policy which begins with many repetitions and ends with many alternations. In order to validate that the point we identified as the optimum really is the optimum, we ran approximately 50 more participants at the optimum and at each of these hand-picked points in the space, as shown by these circles. The mean recall accuracy of these final participants, shown here, is consistent with our model's prediction. Just don't ask me if those differences are statistically reliable. I've presented an alternative to traditional A-B testing that allows us to efficiently search over a continuum of alternative instructional policies to discover the optimum. We've used this approach to optimize instructional policies relating to the presentation duration of examples, relating to fading, the manipulation of the difficulty of examples over time, and also relating to blocking, the manipulation of the sequence of category labels. The work I've presented can be extended in several ways. The work I presented optimized for a population, but the same technique can be used to discover policies that are conditioned on characteristics of an individual. I'll be presenting a poster at the Data-Driven Education Workshop describing a personalized approach to training in a semester-long classroom study. The work I presented involved continuous policy spaces, but Gaussian process techniques can be used for discrete spaces too. And finally, the work I presented involved low-dimensional policy spaces, but we can extend the framework the higher dimensional spaces, especially if we're willing to sacrifice global optimization in favor of hill climbing. We've focused on optimizing instruction, but the same approach can be used for other human optimization problems that have traditionally been addressed by A/B testing. Some examples of what we're working on include maximizing charitable donations by manipulating the suggested donation anchors, improving discriminability for the visually impaired through image transformations, and my favorite, optimizing web design, including layout and color combinations. And thanks, that's it.
Okay, we have time for some questions, but I'd also like to ask the spotlight presenters to start lining up over here. Okay.
So how do you know that they actually learned the graspability concept? For example, size. They could have thought it was size and get pretty good score, right? I mean, so you don't really know what they're thinking.
And we actually think that a lot of subjects were confused with the concept of size. I think if we were to run a follow-up experiment, we would try to come up with maybe a third manipulation that exaggerates the dimension, that this is not, in fact, size, it's something else.
How do the hyperparameters of your Gaussian process supplier affect the results? Are the results sensitive to changes in the hyperparameters?
They're definitely sensitive to it, and we placed vague priors over it, and so each time we ran a participant and used the model to make a prediction, we also had to try to integrate out over our uncertainty. And definitely early on, you can see that the estimates from the model are very noisy because we don't know how smooth the policy space is. But over time, as we get a better idea how smooth it is, we get much better estimates.
Emma Brunskill, Carnegie Mellon. How well do you think this will scale to really large policy spaces like you might encounter with high school algebra?
I think definitely scaling Gaussian processes to very large scales is a difficult problem. But I think the direction we want to go is to condition it on characteristics of an individual and thereby kind of cheat and make sure that we're always working with reasonably sized problems.
Great. So if we don't have any other questions, let's thank Robert again.